In this little video, we'll be making the sword Ascension from the book series The Winter Saga by Christian Rivers. Now, normally to see one of my full-length build videos, you have to be one of my Patreons, but as well as commissioning the sword, Christian has also bribed me to release the full unsegmented video publicly to YouTube so everyone can enjoy it. The very least you could do is maybe go check out the link to the book in the video description. And it's a post-apocalyptic sci-fi thing set 250 years after most of humanity has been wiped out by an engineered supervirus. And the remains of humanity live in floating super cities over a wrecked Earth. So, you know, prescient. Also, because it's being commissioned by the person who made it up, I don't have to be cagey about showing source material images of the sword. So I'll put it up here in this empty patch here. There'll be a nice little video of a 3D rendering of what the sword is supposed to look like, rotating like a rotisserie chicken. That's it. Check out the book in the video description. Here's the video.
Whew. Oh, there's bubbles at least. So hopefully that means it... Oh, I can see that it worked. There's still no hose set up because it's too cold. Oh, let's see if the other side go. It did, but it's more difficult.
Whew. I notice I often breathe properly again once the final cut is done. I must hold my breath, trying in an attempt to keep my body steady while I'm cutting an outline normally. Oh boy. So I'm going to start by drawing a series of straight lines on these curved lines and knocking huge chunks out with the angle grinder, because this would be a thing I would be normally tempted to plasma cut out, but I'd be worried about the heat wrecking the temper on the material. We want to preserve as much of that as we can. Probably gonna wind up having to oxyacetylene burn out this part. So there's two little bits holding the plate, this section on here and here. So I'm gonna zap the outside of the cutter. Today. Well, the joys of living in the woods, I guess. The wind knocked out the power. So, this beautiful, sunny, blustery day, I gotta go find something else to do. So, children, in conclusion, during the Cold War, the use of this fake scrotum concealed escape radio was so common that suspected US spies captured behind Soviet lines, GRU members would routinely listen to their scrotums to see could they hear Jimmy Carter. Thus concludes our homeschooling lesson for today. Any questions? The power came back late last night, but by the time it came back, I was not really in the mood for doing this. Hopefully there's no more nonsense. I'm going to plasma cut out this edge. I was originally thinking I'd have to gas burn it, but this stuff cut relatively okay.
So I think I'm going to risk plasma cutting it. Oh, to sharpen it again, it broke. The Hardox keeps breaking the tips of the thing. It'll make it easier retracing the line if I have just these hard points on the surface that the heat won't erase. So I tried to slope it this way, all the way around, because that way, when I'm dry grinding the inside, I don't want to get into a situation where these marks, these cut marks, are actually eating into the surface that I want. So that's slant. I probably overdid it in some spots, but that's way easier to fix than if any of these were undercut. Holy crap! Oh, the blank might get a bit lighter when I sharpen it, but then it'll get heavier again when I stick on the brass side parts, so it's gonna be heavy sword. I don't even need the table to be level. I just need it to be flat. So, there's a gap here, which would suggest that this end needs to come down. Okay, so it's not a perfect science. We have a floppy piece of wood, a big, huge plate with a slight bend in it from all the years of abuse I've given it. But as far as I can adjust, using the level, where'd I put it? Over there. This is more or less flat, and so I've just extended the die grinding table out, so to make it a bit easier on myself. That's the smaller die grinder bit that I had to use to get in here and in here. Inside here was a bit harder because it was plasma cut out, oxyacetylene and then plasma cut, so it had a rough ass edge. The previous die grinder bit, the big one, it was getting blunt on me towards the end. I think this might be the largest part I've ever had to die grind the entire outer surface of. Yeah, the die grinder bit was getting way too hot, and the brazing holding the stem on finally gave out. I didn't know really, I mean, I guess I kind of knew, but I didn't really appreciate the fact that these things were brazed on. I don't know what temperature that bit must have been for it to fail like that, but it was hot. So here we have a humongous piece of brass, half inch thick, by 20 by 6 or 7, 6.5. The problem is cutting out the shape we need to cut out. I'm pretty sure it'll grind okay. Not grind, sand, I should say. But cutting out the raw shape is going to be a technical issue. So we're just going to do a little bit of experiments. I want to see will the plasma cutter work, because obviously if the plasma cutter works, that will be the easiest option. But I really have no idea. I've never worked with brass much before. To give myself every advantage I can, the plasma cutter is turned up sky high and it's got a brand new head in it. So let's see, does this work? Because the internet has been telling me mixed things about plasma cutting brass. Because it's brass, not steel, it's not having the reaction to the airflow. I just feel like I'm using some sort of torch that I'm not in. It feels like bad torch cutting when you don't have the oxygen flow set up right. The next thing I want to try is handheld bandsaw. But even if this does work, the shape of the bandsaw is very limiting. So I'm not sure how useful this will be, but we'll give it a shot anyway. Okay, so that definitely cut through. The brass didn't choke the blade, but like I said, limited utility because of the shape I have to cut out. Oh, see how hard it is to cut with just a hacksaw, because this actually might have more utility. I have a feeling there's going to be a lot of hacksawing in my future. I'm going to have to look up how to stop a regular file getting choked up. Now, one last thing I want to see before I proceed any further. Now, I've turned the die grinder speed down to 3. Nice! See the little pile of gold it left? So yeah, I think that's going to work. If I could horse out the shapes I need somehow, I'll be able to clean them up with the... The main thing I'd have to worry about is this guy choking with brass. Like if this thing was just filled up with brass, that'd be bad news. But no, that was fine. How dangerous is this stuff? I don't know. What's holding that on? Huh. So, all the teeth on that guy are still intact. I didn't actually have any, I decided to try one last thing, which I thought of earlier, but then I forgot, which is a metal cutting blade for a jigsaw. But I didn't have a metal cutting blade for a jigsaw, so I cut one out of an hacksaw blade. Because of, raid on a bunch of stuff that was being thrown out, I have a load of hacksaw blades, so it's slow but actually cuts relatively nice. It gives a nice cut, and I think that will solve a lot of like the problems with being able to get into places if I can just drill big holes and jigsaw in the holes. This will be the very slow, cumbersome answer to my troubles. This or its millions of brothers and sisters I'm going to wind up cutting out of bits of hacksaw blades. Holy hell, this is proving cantankerous. God damn. Oh wow, the thing is bent, that's why it's acting cantankerous. It's a start.
is the camera standing in the spot where I want to stand? It is. Don't know if it helps, but this is a second blade I've cut because I wanted to adjust the tongue. The tongue is now uneven, so it touches off certain parts of the. I don't know. It's not like a normal tongue now. It's like a custom made tongue for the jigsaw, and I decided to face the teeth in the other direction too. There we go. It's hard on the old wrists. When it's working properly, it's not the best cut ever. There you can see that this is what the side of the cut looks like. Some of it is polished and some of it is rough. Like the brass itself either has variable hardness or the swath from the brass dust, which it's cutting, is getting squished up against the side of the cut wall. So I have a working principle now that I can use for the rest of it. I used a file to just scrape out the cut line like a scribe. So I might do that for the rest of it before I continue. It finally happened! The bandsaw, the jigsaw blade broke. It had done all along here. So, and then finally gave up here. But I think that's pretty good. Like, I think if that is the right that I have to make the mesh, then this is worth doing. So I'm just going to make another one and keep going. Holy moly. See the short buddy blade? I realized I didn't have to cut. This is the third or fourth one I cut. I realized that some of this big pile of hacksaw blades I have, some of them are cheap brass ones and some of them were better ones. It's hard to tell because they're all slightly rusty, but this one that I cut out of had all fresh teeth and looked like it had never been used. So that one managed to cut way more than there was two of them I was using up here and they were so slow. Now to figure out this part. I need to drill holes in the brass. People online have been saying things to me like rake angle and other mysterious phrases. But basically, drill bit has to be a little bit blunt to drill the brass. That looks gross. I'm gonna test it on a little sample piece and see does that work. Yeah. Okay, so that went through. It was relatively painless. Wondering, did it make a mess of the surface? Because later on in this process, I want to drill nice, neat holes. Oh, I can't hold this with a magnet because it's brass. So on the side it bursts through, it's a nice, neat hole. But on the side it went in, there's just the slightest weirdness on the edge. Yeah, I have nightmare memories of drilling brass, and that drill bit that with the rake angle reduced, definitely way easier than my nightmare memories. So the point of taking out the corners of the holes, obviously, was so that I could do this, get it right in the place where it needed to be. Pencil grinder is actually way faster at removing this brass material for whatever reason. So I'm going to remove the majority of in here with this and then clean up the edges with the die grinder instead. So I am having to stop every so often while doing this and oh, I just finished and it's not so bad because it's not long since I did the last time. But I'm using a single cut die grinder head because I almost never use this head. I think I gave a little experimental go on some steel part a long time ago and went bleh, and then just put it away. But it's easier to clean out the brass because the brass is adhering inside the teeth, and just by sticking the end of the bit into this hole and scrubbing it with the steel wire brush and giving a poke along the veins with this knife, I don't know, I had to clean it out 5 or 6 different times while doing that. But that's the inside of this done now. Now to do the entire outer diameter, yay! So that's that more or less done. That was an interesting 2-day adventure. Gotta cut out the other one now. Whew! That's plate number 2 cut out. I'm not exactly sure what order everything's going to be in. No, but I must have already talked about taking the rake angle, the scoopy part of the drill bit down so it can drill the brass properly. Now what I want to say is, can you use pilot holes on brass, or is that a disaster? Like, I've drawn a scribed line on this thing and I want to see how accurately the drill picks up holes and lands in the place you think it's going to land and all the rest of it. It had a rough start, but it looks like it is following the hole properly. I want to sand that off and see how close it is to actually being in the right place. The surface of it is just a little bit messy, which I don't like, but the positioning of the hole is more or less perfect. And the big thing is whether this guy positioned this thing properly. I might buy a 10mm reamer or something. What I want to try here is bonding brass to steel using silicon bronze. It's technically possible. It's like a form of TIG brazing. But the problem is, the video said for heavy gauge stuff, you might need helium. I don't have helium, I have argon. So we're just going to see how this goes. The technique looked exactly the same as TIG welding in the video. So I'm just going to try it and see what happens. Bonding to the steel, but not to the brass. What? Oh, it's only set to 140. I'm going to set it higher, see what happens. A little thing here, like normally when you get like a little bit of crap in your weld, I'm gonna see, can I take it out? Now I wonder how strong that actually is. Because of the curved shape of the guard pieces, even if this does just come off with no effort whatsoever, it's not disastrous. Because I think even a relatively weak weld will work on a big curved surface. And it's going to be a long, I don't know, at least 20 inches of that kind of weld. Braze, I should say. And this is 3 inches. But let's, for the laugh, let's see. But no, even with my finger, I mean, it's not a weld, it's a braze, so it is weaker. But that's not as crappy as I expected it to be. If I kept going, that'll just break off. So I can lift it up with my hand. But still, it's got structural integrity even at the 45. That's wobbly. Still wobbly. Wobbly. Then break it all the way over. Now the language is a bit strange because we can't really talk about penetration stuff. But I can see that there's brass in here. Like some of the brass is still stuck to the steel. Stuff that would make me worry is if when I broke it off, all of the silicon bronze was stuck to either one or the other, but the fact that it's split 50-50 is a good sign. That means it's actually sticking. So this guy is called an optical punch. I just noticed in the last video, there was a bunch of people who were like, what's that thing? So the way this guy works is, this guy has a little lens in it, and we switch to manual focus, and we focus it up. So, where's the light? I'm shining a little flashlight in through the side of this thing. So there's a dot in the middle of the circle. And so I put it on here like this. And then I can slide this guy out. Oh, can I? It's practically touching off the lens of the camera. And so that's what this thing is. And then can I slide this other guy in with the lens here? Just barely. Can you see that the... And then you slide the center punch into where the... little clear thing was that has the crosshairs, whop, right in the right place. I just wanted to keep it tacked for drilling these holes, so these holes wind up in the exact same place on both plates. So, the holes are all drilled through this guy, and so what I'm doing here is I just want to drill through these plates to get some good marks on the plate. Three, and now time for a new drill bit on the hardened plate. Oh, these are only the cheapy drill bits, but still. Two little tacks, so I kind of liked how hard that was to take off. And there's my marks. I was kind of dreading that I'd flip this over to find out that I'd somehow inexplicably missed one of the holes. It's actually bonkers what I plan to do, because I can't drill and tap the hardox. It's too hard. Look how safe the air is in here to breathe. There's a fine coating of brass over everything. It's more obvious than the grinder dust because it's yellow. Whew! But that seemed to Hot, hot, hot. I could smell the wood burning. But that seemed to sand okay.
So, because Hardox is impossible to basically drill or tap, I mean, you can just about drill it. What I plan to do is burn these guys through, then
weld in pieces of half-inch bar, which I can drill and tap, and then secure the thing to the surface that way. It's a little bit crazy, but I think it'll work. So I center punched around the outside because I knew the heat would totally obliterate the marks I needed to see. Normally, when you cut a hole in a big ass material, blind like this, you'd go like this, but I'm too worried about breaching the perimeter, so that's why I did it that way down below. But that's a, it's a real good way to mess up the heads of your thing. This is a strange case. And so forth and so on. Okay, that's the idea. It's gonna get tedious! Where's the thing gone? Here. Do I have a pen in my pocket? Probably not. Ooh, I do! Here we go. Opening it with my cap, with my teeth. It's ouchy. That's not... Why is life so hard? Oh, mein Gott. Watch now as it turns out the pen is dead. Holy crap, there we go. That was harder than I think it had any right to be. Now. Where'd it go? I was standing on the wrong side. Oh look, it just fell over here. Okay, cool. Hot, 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 hot. So, gotta make a bunch of these guys. I wanted it because just to, you do it with this just to ensure that they're 90 on both sides because it'll make my life easier. If I were a smart man, I would have taken the scale off this beforehand, the gray stuff, because taking it off these short little nuggets is bananas. I'm slightly worried that the scale, if left on, would interfere with the weld. The TIG welder is fussy. And speaking of that, after I clean this up, I'm going to have to clean up the holes, the plasma cut holes as well, because of the heavy scale type layer that leaves too, the TIG welder hates that as well, that makes crappy welds. Now, a thing I want to check. I put this guy on here. Make sure there's just a little bit around here for trimming. Everything is lined up properly. This could go back just a smidge. Actually, I'm going to draw a line around here, but it might get obliterated with the heat. What I want to do is draw a hole in the bottom here. Alright, not draw a hole, draw at the bottom of the hole. And then see that how that lines up with those little nuggets. Blech. So this is exactly why I did it. Is why does this have two? Or this one could go over this way. This one could go over this way. This one I'm not sure about. Okay, now let's see how that does. Much better. Okay. Okay. Now, those are ready to clamp and get ready to weld. I might die grind these guys and get another attack in that side, but that's kind of what I'm going for. And these guys are a little bit bumped up on this side. They're just a tiny, like probably the width of the Sharpie from cutting them. But my hope is they're actually flat against this surface on the other side, because if they're not, it might be fine, but it's just unprofessional if I can't polish them back to be like this flat surface for drilling and tapping. I trimmed down the other side, I bumped them down. This is the other side. They feel flat to me, so I don't know how much better I can do than that. So these guys are ready to just weld fully. So now I'm going to flatten these out so that they're, I mean, they don't have to be perfectly smooth. They just have to be not bumped up on the surface. And I think perfectly smoothing them off might cause more problems, maybe, than, like, I might just leave well enough alone and just sand around the sides without trying to get it perfectly matched to the surface. And then flip it, finish the welds on the other side, and do the same thing. I'm just going to give it a little rub with this thing, because it's hard. These surfaces are lumpy bumpy now, but I can't tell if any of them are actually higher than the level of the plate. Give him a little tickle with this guy. Is this guy sitting flat? Set up something. The drill bit I need to use is too small to fit in this chuck. I don't have a different chuck that is the right size. So this is in one of my tripods, and that's the answer. Oh boy. Do this whole, I have to flip the whole thing around. I was expecting this to just break off, but it's, oh boy, whoa, there we go. These are my marks for where to drill on the surface, but they have to actually be drilled at a smaller size because they're getting tapped.
I was even a good boy, and I went and I got the number 25. Is it 25? Yeah, using for the 1024s that have to go in here. Thing the strips out about number 47, 50,000 million. This is the other side, the opposite side. Do these holes line up? Because if they don't line up, they look pretty good to me. All I can do is tap them and see what happens. It's a brand new tap. And now it's just a lot of this. Yeah, I'm gonna check in when I've when this long boring part is over. I snapped a tap and it made me nervous, so now I'm just gonna use this guy to start them off. That's already bitten in. That seems unlikely. I only just give it like a half a turn. Huh. Weird. Okay, I guess. Huh. So, another tap snapped in this hole, and it snapped in such a way that I can't get it out. So we have to do plasma cutter surgery, which I hate, but we have no other option. Now, the main thing I want to watch out for is on the reverse side. Did I wreck the hole? Because if I wreck the hole, my life's... I mean, I just have to line up the plates and blah, blah, blah. But let's see if the hole on the other side's still round. Yes, so I can use this as a guide to re-drill it when I fill in this crater with a little bit of weld. Okay, that's the hole cleaned out of all the... crap, and now I gotta weld it. I doubt I'll be able to get all the way down to where I need to, but I'll be able to get up on at least a quarter inch of weld on the surface. I'll see how I do. I'll nip pieces and drop them down the hole like I've done on previous projects. That thing sounded like it snapped for a second, but it was the bit of uneven weld on the other side of that plug weld snapping. So I've started treading this hole, but I think I'll film it again just in case something stupid happens. I widened it out because I was worried that the holes weren't lined up properly to 5/32, which is a little bit bigger than the number 25 that it was supposed to be. Is that true? I can't remember. I checked the chart because the tap doesn't look like it's going in perfectly straight to me, and it's tapping through weld of variable hardness, so this is just a nightmare. I want to go as careful as I can, because if this breaks a second time I will feel incredibly stupid. Finally, true. That was stressful. Whew. Okay. Now that this is sandwiched, I can trim this perfectly to line up. I can clean that up more, but I don't want to before doing the actual brazing and stuff.
Okay, that's enough. I can get the rest by hand. Whew! Inch and a half of material. There's a little ledge there, but I think I'll be able to sand that out. The main thing was where the brass plate meets the steel plate. There's a lump here I'm not thrilled about, but the rest of it I think is pretty good. 37? I was timing how long this took. It didn't take that long at all. Maybe 10 minutes. I wasn't sure how... mask back on. This brass dust is not great. I was worried that this guy was going to take ages. Now that these guys are kind of indexed to each other pretty well, I can take these brass plates off and prepare to grind them. I can use these holes to screw it down, hold it in place while I grind. Before I do that though, I want to mark the top. This here, I was going to say, is this extra bit sticking out? You know, like a burr on the end, but it's not. I'm just going to put a mark on the end here. Look at all the brass dust that got between the plates. Now, because of hand smoothing and stuff, if I put this plate up against this plate, this half-inch plate in the middle might have generated sufficient parallax error that if I use these holes to line up the two plates, these middle parts mightn't line up properly, and then that would make a nonsense of using that to line up these, but we'll see. I can kind of get these two guys to line up, but as I was worried about, there's like little discrepancies. No, but you know what? It's not terrible. I think I'll be able to, if I'm able to get these guys screwed together so that I can do these edges, line these edges up with each other. And then the plates will be ready for the actual big grinding. That's me for today, but I'm covered in brass dust, which my understanding is that's not great. There we go. Ugh, the camera's covered in it too. Now, we're going to do a quick experiment, and I really super duper don't know how it's going to turn out. An experiment in setting up a jig for grinding cubic zirconia. Oh my god, weld you bastard. This could end bad in several ways. The cubic zirconia might be so hard that it shatters whatever I use to grind it. The cubic zirconia may grind, but get so hot that it shatters. So, we'll see. Okay, so it does grind, so that's a good start. Holy moly, I don't think I've ever used a P1000 belt for anything. But I use it for grinding the smoothing the back of this. So, that wasn't as nightmares as I thought it was going to be. The only things to watch out for is there's a little line here. Since this sandpaper stuff took so little time, I think I'd actually, if I was doing it again, the secret would be to do less with the angle grinder and move onto the belt a little bit quicker. But let's see what that... looks like... Wouldn't it be funny if the little cubic zirconia had cracked in two and it was just this thing that was holding it in place? And by funny, I mean terrible. No, it's still one piece. Is it cracked? Is that what I'm seeing? It's cracked. That's what I was looking through at. I'm going to have to do another experiment again. But this may not be possible to do. So I haven't unscrewed it yet, but I think that was it. Third time the charm. I did a second one. Oh, can I get that out of this hole? I put it in the hole just for... I did a second one that didn't break. But it has a bunch of cracks. The back of it has a bunch of little cracks. And the surface of it, you can see through it to the cracks. Like there's these, you know, like it looks kind of cool, but it's, you know, definitely broken. Whereas this one... The back of this guy is completely smooth. There we go. So the back of that guy is smooth. That's 1000 grit. So the difference was, it was 120 aluminum oxide grit belt, and that was the one that made it all crack and break and stuff. I changed out to a 240 grit belt. The reason I started with the 120 grit belt is I was worried about the time, because these things are supposed to be as hard as diamond. But that didn't take very long to do at all, so I think this is a good little system. I also increased, I don't know, did that make a difference? You know, just throwing everything at the wall. That's 3 layers of this tape. Maybe just to increase to decrease the pressure, that I thought maybe there was something about it, the holding mechanism being too brittle. So there's no cracks. Is that a scratch or just dirt? It's just dirt. So it's hard to make out, but if you see through to it, you can kind of make out that there's a matte back to it by looking down through it. But I think it's acceptable. And that's it flattened out to being only 1/8 inch wide. So that's how much deeper the arrangement can go there. So I don't know, it might be about another 3 millimeters. After doing all of them, interesting things emerged. I kind of got into a groove of doing them. I was shocked at how the variance between them. They're not all made equally. The white ones didn't break at all when I tried it. The yellow ones, despite having... Obviously, the blue ones, I filmed the first two of them breaking, but I didn't know what the hell I was doing. The yellow ones, despite me having a pretty good protocol, two of them broke. The black ones... 3 of them broke. The red ones, one of them broke. Pink ones, one of them broke. And the green ones, none of them broke. So it is amazing to see the variance. The final pattern was locking it into here, but not too tight. Using my finger to cool it off. Instead of trying to dunk it into the water. And then I was a 120 belt. The 240 belt, a 400 belt, and then finally the 1000 grit belt. And that seemed to reduce the amount of heat on them. So that's all these guys shaved down now. That's a thing I never thought I'd have to do or deal with. But there we go. So now after grinding the gemstones down so that I can get this thing deeper, that's the new black line. So grinding this thing, part 2, electric boogaloo. This may not even be a good angle to mark it from. I think I'm going to mark it from the back because I'm worried this slope here may have had some variance. And I'd really love to get this top bit here the same on both sides. Okay. I'd have to look at the 3D model again, but if there's a line across here, and there should be a line across here, but there isn't. So I'll have another sneaky peeky at it. And there's a line across here too. Which is a little odd, because if there's a line across here, then there has to be some sort of thing here, but there isn't. Match it up as best I can. Even though, since everything was trimmed to match each other, which is more important, you know, the template is a little bit messy. Okay, well, I can start by bringing this down. I started grinding this with this guy locked in here, and just the angle was messing me up a little bit, so I've screwed this guy onto here. The air in here is foul. This is a way better angle with the big grinder. Even with the mask, I was starting to feel a little bit doing this stuff in the grinding the brass indoors, so I've moved it out here. So this is one of those things where is it? I opened up my finger with an angle grinder last year, the year before, or something like that, and it's mostly fine. But every so often, I find something it can't do. All I need to do is put that piece of paper down. And whatever way the nerves are sliding across the tendons or whatever. Come on. Come on. Come on. Oh! Nope, too jerky. There we go. The other time I notice it is I don't play with consoles very often, but if I'm over at a buddy's house, shoulder buttons on a controller are very hard for me to press accurately. There's some like mass of scar tissue and the tendon not lined up right. Wear your gloves, kids. This transition is weird, but that's like how it was in the model. I might blend it out a bit with something a bit softer. I think the way I make this transition make sense is I need to turn this guy into a slope. Yeah, I think this transition from this kind of weird bevel thing to this in here works better as this little slope. Normally when I'm sharpening things, I go to the line and maybe even a little bit over the line, but I'll have to be careful around here to not undercut the brass piece, so I might just give it a little bit extra. Now, just for the laugh, I've put the two side pieces on and I want to just see what that handle feels like. Oh my god, it's a heavy sword. The handle actually feels nice, even if it's a heavy thing. Ooh. 261, so if it's 0.8, it lost close to 2 pounds of material of being ground away, If it's 0.4, it only lasts closer to 1 pound of material of having all the stuff ground away. And that's if my previous measurement of 40 pounds was correct. If it wasn't, I'll insert a thing on the screen here now to see what it actually is, but I don't know. That's funny. I would have thought that it would have lost more material, but I guess not. So this thing I put along the edge is because on the 3D model it looks like it has an edge, and I'm worried that this guy here is so shallow that with my angle grinder technique for sharpening, the definition of this edge might get a bit blurry, although this is half inch thick stock, it'd probably be fine. But to kind of mimic the 3D model, I put this deeper groove just along where the cutting edge meets the body of the blade, I should say. But I should have realized this a month ago. This tail part here and this part here, they have a similar problem to the Warden twin blades, where it'll have this weird butty thing if this top edge is half inch thick by the time we get up to here. So the dreaded distal taper. I'm not going to do a full distal taper because A, the 3D model looks like it doesn't have one. Like, it's a similar thickness for most of along the back. And it's hard to tell, but to my mind, it looks like that the taper starts at about here and then goes down to here. So that's what we're going to do. And to try and keep this grain all facing in the same direction, I'm going to, like, you know, keep... I kind of have to polish this top half to look after grinding it, and that's going to be a big job. And then I have this little buddy one on the back to do too. Have to make this. This one's going to be real pointy. But yeah, I have to do that. And that means I'll have to re-grind this line once that's done. So I was kind of freaking out that doing the distal taper, you'd be able to tell that the thing was sloped, that it would be obvious where it slopes, but it's not. And you can kind of see where it starts to fade out this groove that I did. I'm going to have to redo the groove, but yeah, that's not bad looking at all, and it didn't take very long to do, so... And I think I'm going to wait till I have this halfway sharpened. I can use a piece of quarter inch slid up to it with a flat thing. But I can only do that if I refrain from doing the other side of this distal till I have this guy down to halfway sharpened. Because if I do both halves of the distal, I don't have any guide for making sure the blade edge actually runs up the middle. So I have to finish this side first. This is very hard to film. So that's the basic idea. Is that more fluff stuck to the end of this thing? God damn it. So that's the basic idea, that this guy comes to a point. It only starts about here, tapering down. Oh. And then like this, and like this. And it makes this bit here at the end actually pointy to do the distal taper. And so that's that thing. And now I was worried about that, so I was doing it first. And now I have to do the taper on the tail of it. Oh, with the light, you can't even see that other bit of stuff. Anyway, there we go. This is just a piece of flat stuff clamped underneath here where it's still flat. This may seem a little weird, the way I'm sharpening this one. I normally do it just all in a line, but this is the next problem section I'm slightly worried about, so I'm going to do this section next, and then the rest of sharpening it should be standard. It's just this one, this is a weird tight curve, like it's going to have a different level of slope here than it will have here, than it'll have here, so even this, the 3D model has this line here, which I don't think makes any sense. The line should be back here, like going across this way, by all rights. So I'm going to see, is this one possible? And if this is impossible, I'll shift it over this way. The edge needs some minor adjustment, but that's nearly there. Okay, that's pretty good. Good enough to move on to the next stage anyway. Okay, that came out pretty good. Now I'm going to do this section, and all the rest of it is like just standard what I normally do. But I'm going to do this section first, because the last thing I'm worried about, I mean, I have to all do this on the reverse side too, but the last thing I'm worried about is this line here, this unusual bevel transition. So I'm going to see, can I get that? This was tricky, especially up here towards the top. Something weird here that might need more work. But I think, other than that, I managed to get the line in the right place. Oh wait, you can see it more in certain shadows. Yeah, there's the weird thing. That's that part roughed out, but this has been happening the entire time. I don't know, is it more exaggerated with this because I sharpened the tip first? But yeah, look at all the magnetism. All the filing sticking to the
edge and radiating out. Neat looking. That was 80 grit, and this is 120. But it's 120 from a belt that I cut out, and I find that is more severe on the surface than the 100 grit that's just cut out from a regular sheet of sandpaper. So, it was just, there was all sorts of little dips and hollows from the angle grinding, which is basically like freehand napping of the surface. So this is just to smooth out everything. So that's both sides of this thing sharpened. Now I just have to clean it up. So these guys that I'm going to use to hold on the plates, they're 3/4 inch, I think. But maybe 1/2 inch. And I need them to be 1/4 inch. So that means I got to shorten them all. After doing that, I'm running them through a tap, but this is a die, the opposite of a tap. Just to clean up the ends where it got cut. Okay, now will this just go back in by hand? Yes. Okay, so I have to do that 14 times now. So the depths of these holes were controlled using the drill, but the height, this side that we're looking at, wasn't really controlled at all, other than a Sharpie line and me using an angle grinder. So there's some little variances between the depths of the holes. Like, see this one here? I want to get it so that the ridge on top is all the way in the hole, if not even a little bit deeper, and this one is peeking out. So I'm going to drill that hole just a little bit deeper. Move these guys to safety. And the gems were also ground in a jig, but kind of basically by hand. So all of this is going to have to be, it's going to be individual gems matched to individual holes. So I'm going to have a way, luckily the gems are colored. So I only have to keep 2 sets of gems isolated from each other for this to work. Actually, I need one more thing. Because I'm going to back the gem holes with silver, I also need to control for, not silver, I'm going to put on top of the bolt heads, because on the lighter gems you can see through, I'm going to put the silver tape, which is, aluminum foil tape, and it's got a thickness itself, so I also need to control for that. So I need to make a little circle of this as well, for checking my depths with. Is that a siren? I think I heard a siren. You rarely hear a siren around these parts, but that's the coronavirus, I guess. Now, will this work? Because I have to do a whole mess of these, I want to have a quick way to do these. So that makes a button. Maybe the leather was actually too giving. I could just do this. Because I just need the height of the thing. But yeah, that'll do for me for height. But first I want to see, does this guy work better on the cutting board than the piece of leather? Yeah, no, that was better. Less messy. Do they actually fit in the holes? That's the other part. Yeah, perfect. So that's the bolt with the silver stuff on top. And so that's the height it needs to be. I didn't think of it, but since this little 1/4 inch plate is 1/4 inch, if I get too deep, I shouldn't get too deep, but I can spot the bolt coming out through the other side of this and know I'm in trouble. One down, 13 to go, yay. Oh, also it turned out that shooting was some
kids' indoor birthday party. They said, oh, we're sorry, you can't have a birthday party because of the coronavirus. Instead, let's fire a whole mess of guns out, and have a parade of police cars. So, thanks for telling all of us people who live nearby, I guess. Now, we're going to do an experiment. Want to see, can I get this brass to turn a kind of reddy color? Now, what I really need is hydrochloric acid, some sort of drain cleaner with hydrochloric acid. But, I don't know, I have this old ferric chloride. And ferric chloride is a copper etchant, which is the exact opposite of what I want to do. I'm trying to dissolve the zinc in the brass. I'm going to put my mask on in a second to bring the copper out. And I have no idea, will this do a similar thing? But we'll see. I have no idea, will this work? We'll just try it. And this is old ferric chloride too. It's not even that new. This is just something I had lying around. So I'm going to paint this on. And then we're going to leave that there. And then I'm going to come back and see, did that have any actual effect? I moved it over there. Try and give it a bit warm. Nice and fumy. But watch what it's doing to this. The aluminum jaw, it's already started bubbling. Cloth. No, it hasn't like taken big gouges out of it. But it was definitely reacting with the aluminum. If this doesn't work, I'm going to have to bite the bullet and go out into the wider coronaverse in search of some horrible hydrochloric acid-based drain cleaner. Okay, this guy has been sitting here for like an hour while I was doing different stuff. And now, let's see, did it work at all? Holy moly! So that definitely works. It's a bit uneven. What happens if I do this? Get a little bit of Scotch-Brite. It's a relatively thin layer, but I think this avenue has some promise. The thing I wanted to see as well is how much slipped underneath. Haha! That's a very clean line, you would agree. It is possible to mask it properly. We're going to spray these. And I'm going to babysit them for a half hour. All of this is very toxic. Masks on! Broke. Now, ferric chloride is pretty toxic. I'm pretty sure under no circumstances you should aerosol it. Goggles. But I want to get an even coverage, so here we go. Because this isn't a flat surface like my chest piece, I think I'm just going to have to babysit this for a half hour. It looks like they're done, but I'll rinse it off and see. So here they are after doing the thing, and they're very interesting looking. It kind of makes these interesting stippled patterns, but then it looks stupid in some places like here. The right way to do this will probably be to submerge them. So this is the next morning, and neither of them, both of them kind of came out funny. This one came out mostly okay, but then a little blob of acid fell out of that fold and landed here and here and took off the copper again. This one was acting weird, I don't know. So I think just spraying them is not going to work. And so I'm going to attempt to build a bath, like a little close fitting bat around them, similar to how I do for doing the electro etching. And it's gonna be finicky and tricky, but I might be able to do it. Who knows? Will this work? Or will this be a disaster? Let's come around the other side so you can see. There's a slow leak on these two sides of the deadly poisonous acid. If I can slide this under here and push down, I think that's it. This is the grate off the back of my fan backpack, and this is an old cat litter tray that I was using last night for catching drips. So same idea here. Because the whole immersion is so much more intense,
I'm going to only leave it in for 15 minutes. This is the part where I should have left a test, done a test piece, but I was so annoyed that last night's adventure is not working. Wow! That didn't work at all. The full immersion just left it yellow. Ah! That means the spray thing is the only thing that works. Dagnammit. Oh, look at it turning green almost instantly. Wow, so weird. There's the red. Underneath the brass? Okay, that did work. Kind of, sort of. I think I'm starting to come round on this thing looking like copper. And then the next step I did on the other sample piece was to rub some cold blue onto the surface. And I think we're only going to leave the cold blue on the surface for 10 seconds. Cool. That really... Oh, I didn't get this side and I didn't get here. So I might do that again from this side and squirt it. But that's the idea. Editor's note, while I was editing the footage, I'm trying to figure out what happened between these two clips, that the copper color is completely gone and it looks like dark brass again. And I think the second spray of cold blue just completely dissolved the thin copper layer. And it was dark, it was getting late, I was tired, and I didn't notice that. And this is why those pieces look so different in the next clip. Okay, so looking at these a day later, these guys are really nowhere near close. So I think I'm going to have to resort to paint, which I hate. The thought of using paint was really, really getting me down. So I'm trying one more thing, and I don't really see why it should be different, but we'll find out, I guess. So I think that needed more. That's way closer to copper than all the complicated things I was doing yesterday. I'll try that again, I guess. So this is attempt two. Holy hell. I mean, that looks pretty coppery to me. I was just over-engineering it yesterday. The answer was to keep it simple. Yeah, no, that's much better. So provided I can replicate this on the second one. Yeah, look, watch. That's so much more copper than all of yesterday's efforts. The answer was directly in front of the heater and a thin layer that is so thin it evaporates, and maybe doing it twice, like doing it twice for good measure, but a thin layer that evaporates is the key, because it's not actually being submerged in the acid. When it's submerged in the acid, like if it has genuine coverage, I think that creates problems. The acid just eats away. But it's when it starts to evaporate and the acid goes away, that's when it turns the surface to the copper. Or at least that's how the ferric chloride is working. So that's the pair of them, and that's much more copper looking. I mean, it's still not the bright red, but it's a million times better than paint. This is kind of the weird thing about being stuck halfway between being a sculptor and someone who makes swords. Like, stuff like this, like weird splotchiness. My artistic sensibilities are like, ooh, isn't that interesting? But I know if you played lots of video games and stuff, you tend to prefer glossy, impossible, mirrored finishes that you get on lots of video game weapons. That being said, though, I don't know. I'm seeing a lot of more modern video games. Instead of doing the glossy, mirrored finishes on their blades, they'll, like, straight up import a texture that's just a photograph of an actual piece of steel with scratches and stuff on it. So, I don't know. The anime guys definitely like their solid, perfect colors with no actual texture or interesting bits on them. Whereas, like, the video game guys might be warming up to the idea of texture. So what I'm going to do here is just a little groove for the braze to sit into. Okay, so we're going to tack this guy in a couple of spots before doing the full braze. A couple of things to worry about. We're
worried about how the braze will interact with the copper emits. And I'm worried doing a, such a long run, I'm going to learn interesting things about braze I didn't know before. Hot. I suspect it won't be as hot as welding steel. I'm still going to wait till it cools down to mess with it. So those multiple spots where there was little things in the weld I didn't like, and so I've ground those out. Weld. It's not a weld, it's a braze. But the brass is kind of spitty, and so I noticed that when I was welding it, so I suspect that's what it is. So, because we're dealing with three separate materials, the brass, the hardox, and the silicon bronze. So I'm just going to try and patch up all of these parts where there was little pinholes, like gaseous expulsions. The other thing is, for this thick material, the recommended gas is helium, and I'm just using the argon, so that might be why there's little dirty spots. But as you can see, like, there's lots of clean bits, so I think it should be possible to just heal these up. Okay, so now there's no occlusions or anything, but it's so weird looking. It's got a couple of, like, parts where the stuff melted more and it's going in, so I don't know, I guess that's just how it looks. Okay, so that's that joined on. It's very strange looking. Now I have to decide what I'm going to do next, whether I'm going to shield this guy off and re-acid this part, or whether I'm going to re-acid the... I have to clean up this and see how much of the copper effect survived all of the brazing and stuff. Because the heat may have done... I think the heat definitely did something funny there, for instance. So I might just wind up redoing the entire handle, which will be a pain in the butt. Now, here's one last thing, because I hadn't thought of it before. The copper on the surface, I've tested it just with, like, rubbing and stuff, and it seems like it's genuinely part of the surface. But the thing I haven't done is WD-40, because I don't put any WD-40 on my swords. People often complain about the lack of cutting oil and stuff in my videos. Until the sword is actually finished with all the welding and stuff, I don't like putting oil anywhere near it, because it can interfere with the welds, even, like, a tiny bit left on the surface if you're doing two plates squished together. So I haven't actually tested. There's no reason why WD-40 would affect it. WD-40 is usually what I spray the swords with once they're done. We'll leave that there, and we'll come back in a while. So, this is hours and hours later, and yeah, the WD-40 doesn't affect the copper, so that's good. I mean, I didn't think it would, because it's not supposed to be corrosive, like, at all. But just have to double check. Okay, I really didn't want to have to do this, but I was cleaning up this edge on the back, and I decided I really needed to grind a lot of it to make it feel okay. So I have to re-acid, re-copper the two handle halves, which is annoying, because I wanted to do that before possibly getting any of the nasty stuff on the actual blade itself. But I guess we're doing it this way. Masks up. Yeah. To leave that for 15 minutes. Now the annoying thing about this is I can't hose it off. I just have to wipe it off. A little bit annoying. Damn it, it's not working. I'm gonna have to do it again. Okay, so that's a couple of attempts later. I don't know why it was so much harder this time, but it was. Okay, so what we have here, if it'll focus, is a little sample piece I did. Come on. For the how to attach the gems. This one is epoxy, this one is shoe goo. The reason I wanted to try the shoe goo is I'm worried about the vibration of the sword hitting stuff a whole bunch of times. And while this isn't a very scientific test, but I thought we could test it a little bit by clamping this piece of the sword and hitting a bunch of stuff and seeing, does this stuff actually, which one of the gemstones, if either, flies out first? Since neither of them actually came out, just through the vibration of being mounted on a sword, and I've seen with like slow motion shots that quite a amount of wibbly wobbly stuff does go through the sword when it's in use. I don't know, I guess we can test other things. Like if you accidentally hit something and the gems themselves got damaged. Now both of these gems, I'm using them because they were reject ones that kind of got cracks in them while I was shaving the backs off them. So they might just break when I do this, I don't know. Haha! So that made the shoe glue one come out. And that made the epoxy one come out. But I would still say the epoxy one was probably better. So, this is two-tone epoxy. Which, like I said, I'm trying to avoid going out because of the Rona. So I am only just using what is on the property here. And I cleaned the holes out. Unscrewed each screw. Acetone and wiping out. I had a tube of tread lock. I used that on the treads, finally. That was a couple of hours ago, so it should be dry by now. This in the hole. I reversed the silver tape on the back, so the silver tape is now, the sticky side is on the back of the gem, which changes things a little bit but makes it so that we won't get the line of the thread on the silver stuff. Okay, perfect. That one glop into the hole. And so I move on to the next one. This is relatively stressful. Now this is a little bit confusing because I... Nova, there's anime music in the background audio of this clip and I can't use the clip because the copyright spiders will go nuts.
Really?
I think it's your fault.
It is. And it probably is.
So as punishment, I think you should have to redub all the audio for this scene.
Oh no. Now, this is a little bit confusing. This is the second side. I think the first one I showed was the rose-colored one. This is side number two. And because the blade is obviously facing the other direction, I'm finishing with the rose-colored one on this side. Things I learned. This stuff says it has a half-hour handling time, but it's actually more like 10-15 minutes. After that, it gets too stiff to manipulate properly. Now, maybe it's because I was talking while doing this here, but a little bit of the epoxy just went up over the rim of the hole. Thankfully, acetone dissolves this stuff while it's still wet. Now I'm going to drop the gem in, and I'm trying to index them so there's a point going 50-50 this away. And plop, there it goes. And we manipulate it with the X-Acto. And now we just don't touch it, and now we're done. They're not quite sunken in, but there's only like 2 millimeters at most sticking up out of the hole. I have the sponge under here. The yellow one on the other side is in danger of touching off a surface.
These guys are done. So, what's the hissing noise? Oh, it's the air. So, this is it all cleaned up and oiled. This is the next day after doing the gems. I had to wait till after the epoxy was set before I squirted it with the WD-40. I'm not sure how not fully set epoxy and WD-40 interacts, but I did not want to find out. So that's that side. I mean, the other side is the same. Can I do this? Oh yeah, hang on, careful. This sword actually stands up on its back, on its spine, like this. So we can do this. Woo! Now I wouldn't leave it like this. Side number two. You see in there. What was the thing? Oh yeah! So this sponge here. I can't tell whether if we take the sponge away for a second. Oh! I can't tell. Is there weight directly on the yellow gem on the other side? But I would guess that there is. So we're just doing this for safety. Come on, come on, come on. There we go. But that's the sword done. It was a long journey, but I'm pretty happy with the way it came out. You know, I think that looks pretty sweet. And so the next step is to figure out some kind of smash video with it. So I asked Christian, who wrote Winterfall, is there anything I could do with the sword to emulate what it does in the book? And he said that it's used by a real bad guy to take off heads. So with the help of Herman and my trusty assistant over there, we're going to try and emulate that. So here we go. So, once again, I'd like to thank Christian for sponsoring this video to be released in its full form on a bridge to YouTube. There'll be a link in the video description to yon book, and also there'll be a trailer for the book at the end after the Patreon credits.
By the mid-21st century, planet Earth is consumed by it. Nearly 250 years have passed since Earth was devastated by the Blight, an engineered supervirus responsible for wiping out humanity and leaving behind a toxic wasteland. Only by the benevolence of Sovereign Zeus did human beings survive. In Olympus, a floating city high above the blighted surface world, humanity thrives once more under his protection and guidance. January Winter Winterton was formulated as a purifier, a genetically enhanced soldier tasked with the divine mission to purify the surface world of the Blight and pave the way for the reclaiming of their beloved homeland. At only 19 years old, Winter has already proven to be one of the most proficient purifiers of her generation, destined for ascension to the heavenly realm of Elysium. But as her choices start her down an uncertain and dangerous path, she'll have to discover where the lies end and the truth begins. Winter's Fall, Book 1 of the Winter Saga by Christian Rivers. Available now on Amazon in book and ebook. Be sure to visit wintersaga.com, like us at facebook.com/thewintersaga, and subscribe at youtube.com/thewintersaga.
May Olympus always smile upon you.